I'm Mr. Palmentieri, and today I'm going to do a different style video. Usually I do a lot of performance videos, teaching videos, but today I'm going to go over easy instrument repair tips for band directors. So if you are an elementary, middle school, or high school band director, and you have no idea how to fix any instruments, today I'm going to go over my top 10 most popular repairs that I make in the classroom. I get paid $0 for my repair that I make in the band room. I would say my repair level is up to intermediate. Okay, I've taken some day courses. I once took a summer course for a week. I've just learned a lot through experience. Some of these tips are just quick fixes. Some of these repairs I would only suggest performing on your own school-owned instruments. Do not perform it on a student-owned instrument for some of them. We're going to go back and forth between brass and woodwinds. You can look in the chapters below. If you like this video, make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit the like button. And if you comment below about a different repair, I will make future repair videos on that topic. Some things are best left to the professionals, but today I'm going to show you easy things. As long as you have a few tools in your band room or a few tools you can purchase, this would go a long way. All right, here are the tools I'll be using today in the video, just to see, you can take stock what you have at your school. But I have black electrical tape with scissors. That's near the end of the video. Pliers I'll be using throughout the video. This is a brass valve cleaner tool. I'll use this as a little circle at the end. I'll use this in conjunction with the rags. You can also use a flute cleaning rod. I have some spring tools. Okay, you can also use a flathead screwdriver. I have some valve oil, a bobcat mouthpiece puller, and a small set of screwdrivers. Today I'm only going to use the two small flatheads, but sometimes you will need the small Phillips. So we're going to start today with trumpet valves. I don't know how many of you have ever had a student come to you and say, my trumpet valve came apart. Okay, so sometimes I'll be zooming in on the video, but a lot of times when students go to take their valves out, instead of unscrewing here by the valve cap, they unscrew from the finger button part that's attached to the valve stem, and that ends up taking the valve apart inside. And then all of a sudden, you're left with all of these parts. Now, not every trumpet's the same, but the easiest way to figure out how to put this back together is to take out another valve inside the same trumpet. And you'll notice right here on the valve, there is a number. So in case you're like, I don't know which order this says 3 right here, and I'm gonna take out the second valve. Okay. So you'll see the second valve is right here where it says 2, and you'll see the guides at the bottom, and then the spring, and then the valve stem screws into the valve. So I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm just gonna leave this out. Okay, here's the right here. And then you just put this back in, you press the spring down. Okay, sometimes that plastic valve guide comes out. You can just turn it sideways and slide it in. Okay, but I'm just showing the basics. So now here we have our third valve and we have our second valve. We're gonna put our second valve back in. I always tell my students, oil your valves one at a time so they don't get mixed up. A lot of times when they're beginners and they take them all out, they usually put them in wrong, and then you need to figure out which order they go in. And depending on the make and model of the trumpet, some trumpets don't put the numbers on them, okay? Those are usually cheaper trumpets, but in case that's you. Now, while I have the valve out, if your trumpet student keeps saying, I keep oiling my valve and it's still sticking, it's very sluggish, many times there's too much oil inside the valve casing. This is where the valve goes, it's called the valve casing. So in this case, we are gonna use a couple more tools. I'm not sure what this is called. It will be in the description below, but we're gonna use this tool and we're just gonna use a rag, okay? So on the bottom of the trumpet, you'll see these bottom caps. Since we have the third valve out, we're gonna take the bottom cap off, and then you'll be able to see the cylinder of the valve casing. You should be able to see right through, and we're gonna fish the rag through this little piece, the brass valve cleaner tool, that's what I'm gonna call it right now, and we're gonna push it through this way, and you can see it come up. And this is essentially drying, taking out all that oil. Okay. Taking all the oil out and drying out that valve. And once you're done, you could take this rag off. If you want to rinse your valve, you can, but I'm just going to wipe it down. Take all that excess oil off. You don't really need to go wild. I don't suggest using a paper towel or a tissue because it will leave a lot of lint. That's why you want to use some kind of cloth. And now essentially you have a dry valve, okay? And this is where you want to start fresh with your own oil, whatever oil you're going to use. Sometimes there's certain oils that mix with other oils, like if they put brand A oil in and then they add brand B or brand C, those oils may not work well together. So that's why we're going to start fresh. We have everything dried out. Just going to put a little bit of oil across the top, just straight across. Before I put that bottom valve cap on, I'm just going to put it in here, okay? Make sure it's turned to the right spot. Okay, and sometimes if it's a little sluggish, I'll take like a marker or a pen. In this case, I have this little piece, and I'll just push it back in and forth. And I always tell students, unless you've pressed it down 100 times, it has time for the oil to settle in, okay? And you do this first. Don't do it over your pants. You don't want the oil to stain your pants. But these are quick fixes. You can put that valve back together and you can oil this valve and clean it in front of the class, okay? And that's the first repair tip. This is just basic valve maintenance. There's another tip later that's gonna go over valves. Now, if you don't have this tool, which I a lot of times can't find this tool, you can take a flute cleaning rod. It's pretty much the same tool. It just doesn't have this ring at the end. It's just longer. And just put the cloth on and you can go up and down inside the valve casing. All you need to do is dry it out. I've taken a paper towel, even though I said not to use them, spun it around, pulled it through, and had a student pull it all the way through. You just want to dry it out, and that will help make sure this is clean, okay? So that's tip number one. I'm going to try to go back and forth between brass and woodwinds. Second tip is a woodwind tip. This is all about if a woodwind instrument, this is saxophone, clarinet, and flute, if a specific key won't play, the first thing you want to check, and I honestly forget this every time, but you want to check the screws, okay? So we're just going to take a peek. We'll start with the clarinet. I'm going to show you a little bit on each of them. Many of the screws on clarinet, we'll just take this key for example, all right? So inside here, this screw actually starts here, and it's a rod that continues all the way down to the bottom, and the threads are at the bottom to connect there. So the screw may only be out maybe a quarter of an inch, but it will disconnect from the bottom, and it looks as though it's just a little loose. So I'm just going to get out one of my screwdrivers. All right, this is one of the tools I suggest having for in your little tool chest. This is not very expensive. All right. These are just small jewelry screwdrivers, okay? And you usually use the bottom two for the clarinet, the two flatheads, okay? And if they're real cheap, a lot of times the heads will break, but there's no substitution. Fingernail, credit card, none of that, all right? So I'm just gonna loosen this a little bit. Okay. And you can see it out a little bit, and right away, not sure how much you can see it. This is a little off. So now this key is really loose. All right. And in order to get this screw out, you have to pull it all the way out. We're not going to pull it all the way out. In order to screw it back in, you need to make sure it's lined up. Okay. This is very hard to do on the camera. And you just want to make sure it's lined back up in the spot. Okay. So that's the first thing you want to check. Now there are some screws on the clarinet that are going to be like the flute and the saxophone, but a lot of them are these rod-like screws. So you want to check and you want to make sure the screw's in all the way. Very rarely will, if you tighten the screw very, very tight, sometimes it will make the key be a little too stiff and you'll have to back off a little bit. So you want to check on that, all right? And once you show the student that screw that came out, remind them to check it each week to see if it's backing out on its own. Okay? All right, so let's move on to the flute. I'll show you some of the flutes. Have a lot of these long rods right here, these long rods, and there's just a little screw on the one end with a little pin on the end, and then there's a screw on the other end with a pin. And sometimes there's multiple little pins in between. So we're just gonna take off. Okay, so you can kind of see. We're going right into this screw right here. Okay. Okay, there we go. Now, if you're just testing this out, don't take the screw out all the way, but you can see right there, it's just this tiny little screw, and right away the rod comes out. Now if I put the screw back in without the rod connected, you'll see, I don't know how much you can see it, there's a little pin there, and that pin's supposed to go through the rod for the flute. So you want to make sure they're aligned, okay? Now I will be honest, on cheaper flutes, a lot of times these brackets where the screws and the posts are connected, where it's like welded to the flute, once the flute's dropped once or twice, that's when things get bent. And depending on how cheap it is, you can usually bend it back into place, but that may be a spot where you don't want to go. So, okay, so you can kind of see it's back in there, but right now it's not really connected well because I haven't screwed it in. There we go. Okay, and these screwdrivers usually are built, the head will spin, so you can put your finger on the end and then spin it around with the other fingers as you get it in there, okay? And we'll talk about springs later, but there's little springs on all these woodwind instruments too, and that's a different repair tip. So I'm just showing you the different screws, where they go in, and I think it's important to show you them on each of the different instruments. Now I've taken most screws out on most instruments, but it's been so long I don't always remember. So I'm just looking at the saxophone. Once again, a lot of rods like the flute and the clarinet. I'm just looking for a spot that looks a little different. So we'll use this alternate F sharp key right over here. This is a key that doesn't get a lot of use in middle school. Most likely there's a screw here and there's a screw on the bottom. If you see the little line for where the screwdriver is going to go on each end, you know there's a screw on each end. On clarinets, a lot of times the one end, that's where the threads go, so you can only unscrew it from the one point. That means there's the rod. Okay, so most of the saxophone are just the little screws. Take out, there we go. Now there's nothing wrong with this saxophone. I do have some instruments that I am going to highlight some issues with today. So, okay, so I'm taking the screw on the top of the octave key out. Well, it's the octave key mechanism. So we have this screw right up here, and you can kind of see it's coming out. This looks more like the rod variation, yeah. So you can see, I'm not going to take it all the way out, but this is connected all the way from here down through in here, and it's just one long rod. So once you start to pull that out, all of this is going to come out. So the best thing to do for you as a teacher, if you see it out, just try to screw it back in, all right? And with a student-owned instrument or a student rental, don't feel afraid about using a screwdriver as long as you're not scratching the instrument, all right? You're really doing the student and the company a favor just by putting in a screw or two, because if that screw gets lost and then it needs to be sent back to the company, they need to pay for a replacement screw. Either the student's family needs to pay or the company if there's a damage waiver on that instrument. So always check those screws. Now what I was saying earlier about the braces on instruments, you'll see there's these little welds that hold on these pieces where the screws go in. You can see the little circle down there where that is at. Okay, you can kind of see it down here. Right down here, you see these posts. There's not huge welds. Usually, the cheaper the instrument, the smaller the weld is going to be. And because that saves them money by not putting as big of a brace. But on flutes, the posts are really small. You can see the post right here. And you can see the post right here. And these posts, if the flute drops and the post bends out this way, that opens it up so that even though the screw's all the way in, it won't connect to the rod anymore, which unfortunately, that's gonna prevent the flute from playing, okay? I'm gonna show you a tip later in case that happens, but the best tip you can tell your students is don't drop your instrument. I know it's easier said than done, don't drop your instrument. And I always tell my students that are playing a school on instrument, you signed a paper that says if you break that instrument, you will pay for the damages. So please be careful, treat it like your baby, okay? All right, so we are gonna move on. Hopefully that gives you a little bit about screws. Most screws on these instruments are flathead. All right, very rarely will I see the Phillips. The clarinet thumb rest a lot of times is a Phillips. So, and those you always wanna check. If a kid says their thumb rest is loose, tighten it right away, because sometimes if one of those screws falls out, you'll never find it, and now you only have one screw and it's very hard to keep it together. We're gonna go to springs and then we'll go back to brass with mouthpieces, okay? So I was showing you a little bit earlier with the flute. I have a few tools here, and a flathead screwdriver or a pen will do fine also. Okay, so I'll take my flathead screwdriver. Here we go, this is a spring removal tool. I have an old school spring removal tool, okay? You can also use a tiny crochet hook. I've bought some of them for my student teachers. A lot of times when we think of a spring, we think of the coiled spring. I'll put one here on the page. But on instruments, it's just a little tiny metal rod. So inside here, you'll see this little rod right here. It's just a little piece of metal and it's held on. Let me see if I can get you in there. It's held on just this little piece, and you see if I just press it, it will just pop right off. And now, when I go to use that trill key, you'll see that trill key stuck open, all right? I have to manually move it up and down because that spring that we took off popped off. So I'm gonna push it back in, and it just needs to go underneath there. All right. And now the trill key is back to working and back to popping up. Now when a clarinet player, flute player, saxophone player says that certain notes aren't coming out, other than pressing the fingers down all the way, the two big repairs are the screw being loose and the spring popping off. Once a spring starts to pop off, unless it's like a very rare occurrence, there's a chance it's gonna keep popping off because something else is loose, but you can show them how to pop it back on. Okay, now I use the spring removal tool. All right, you can use a screwdriver. Let's find a different spring. The springs at the end are a little bit easier to see. All right, we don't really use this low C key, but I'm just gonna pop it off. Okay, so you can kind of see right here, the spring's off. All right, now it's a little bit harder to do with a screwdriver, but you just try to get the flathead part in there and you just push it behind where the spring catches, okay? Now the saxophone ones are a little bit larger. We'll go to saxophone and then we'll finish with clarinet. And you'll notice these, the saxophone ones are spiky, so you gotta be careful of them. All right, so let's look at our low D sharp E flat key down here. Now this key's a little bit different because this key stays closed and then it goes to open, whereas most keys are open and go to close. But that just means the spring pushes it shut, okay? So, and this saxophone's in really good condition, so this never comes off, but you can see, I'm gonna pull it off, and right down there, it's just this black piece right here. I don't know how well you can see it. All right, and it's off the little clasp down here, and all I'm gonna do, you can push it or you can pull it. push it back on. You have to put it over. All right, this one's a little small. Okay. And now the key should be opening back up. I don't know how well you could see that, but. And with the clarinet, these springs can be very, very tiny. There's another type of spring on the clarinet, but most of the ones we're talking about are the ones that I showed you. The easiest one you'll be able to see, this would be the low B natural key or low E natural. Down here, you can see the little rod right next to the piece. I'm gonna try to pop it off of my finger, and you can see the spring just popped off. You could put your finger in there and pop it right back on. Now some of these are really hidden. They're hidden inside of here. So if you ever take this off, you need to try to pop those springs back into place when you put it back together. Okay. I see less spring issues with this. I see them more with saxophone and flute. And a lot of times if you don't know how a specific spring is supposed to go, whether it's supposed to go on the one side or the other, just get another instrument, preferably the same brand, because then they'll have the springs exactly in the same spot. But for the most part, most instruments will have the same number of springs and they'll be in a similar location. We're going on to repair tip number 4. Now, if you've been a band director for at least a year anywhere, you've encountered this issue, and hopefully you know how to solve it. My mouthpiece is stuck, okay? Now there's a chance, if you're teaching fourth or fifth grade, there's a chance that you can just manually pull the mouthpiece out, but a lot of students like to do this, or they drop their instrument on their mouthpiece, and once that happens, unfortunately that creates, that just solidifies the dirt in there and locks it into place. Now, I've heard of stories where students take them home and parents take pliers and try to pull them out. The easiest way to get the mouthpiece off is with this tool. This is called the Bobcat Mouthpiece Puller. When I started teaching, this was $50, now it's $75. And this tool just uses the force of gravity pushing against one end on the mouthpiece, the other end pushing against the lead pipe, and it just pulls the mouthpiece out. That's all it does, okay? So let's just look, in case you've never used this before. This has a few spots. This end is gonna go on the lead pipe and you're gonna tighten these to lock them into place. And you need to make sure that this is low enough, okay? You're gonna be able to turn one side until it doesn't move anymore and then turn the other side. It kind of moves back and forth. And you wanna put that on the mouthpiece. So let's open up the bottom, okay? And you can kind of see there's the lead pipe, right at the tip of the lead pipe. I get that set, and I usually hold my fingers here, even though I'm tightening it up. There's another way to tighten it with Allen wrenches. I always just use my fingers and tighten those. And now you have a good purchase on your mouthpiece. And as you can see, as you pull this up, it's gonna push down against that lead pipe. Now my lead pipe has done this so many times, it's kind of beat up, but it pushes the mouthpiece out, and voila. So, you can do this on a brass, any brass instrument, trombone, tuba, baritone, okay? If you need more instruction on how to use a mouthpiece puller, make sure you put a comment below and I'll do a separate video just on using the mouthpiece puller. There's other versions out there. I just have always used the Bobcat, and when I took this job where I work now, they had two of their own Bobcats in stock, so we have three of them. There have been days where I have multiple students with their mouthpiece stuck. And I don't take time out of my day. I say, play your trumpet until the end of class, put it on my desk in the front of the room on top of the case. Then later in the day when I have a few minutes, I notice it there, I'll take the mouthpiece out, put everything away in the case, and put the case under the desk. Now we're gonna move on to repair number 5. This is a saxophone only repair, mainly for altos and tenors. Okay, so we're gonna put this back together and I'm gonna bend this saxophone a little bit. And this is where we start getting into the territory about manipulating instruments. And you may not wanna do this to instruments that are not your schools or your own personal instruments. Okay, so we have the saxophone. Anytime you go over the octave, you're pressing this thumb key, This is engaging the octave key up top. Okay, but you'll notice as you go up, you go to the high G, the octave key goes up, high B, high A, high G, then it goes back down and another key will open inside here. Okay, but unfortunately, because students are rough, when they put their instrument together, this octave key mechanism can get out of whack and get a little bit off. Okay, and if this is ever stuck, I always just tell students, wipe off the bottom. You don't need grease. Just wipe this off. In addition to wiping that off, wipe the inside of here off to get the dirt out, okay? Sometimes this and this are out of alignment. So I'm just gonna bend this a little bit just for today, just to show you what I'm talking about. In this case, I don't think the octave key is gonna go up at all because I bent it. So I'm pressing the octave key, but if you notice, now there's a lot of space in there up top, okay? And that's because they bent this when they were putting this on. So there's a fine line between how much this needs to be bent in order for this to go. And this metal is very malleable. So you can hold this down and just pull this up. You don't need to do a lot, just to see about just making it a little bit different, okay? Okay, now one thing I notice a lot is kind of the opposite, and I'm gonna show you that too. All right, just so you can kind of see what I'm talking about. This piece and this piece are sometimes out of alignment. Many times, students can't play low. The octave key is always up. So that means the octave key is too high. The octave key's always open. I'm not pressing the octave key, I just can't play low. So I come over and I hold down this. And if I notice that, then I'm just gonna bend this out a little bit the other way, okay? So this could be something that you look at a different saxophone in the room and you kind of judge against that. And you just kind of see. So this definitely, it's not a big repair. You're just kind of slightly bending the metal one way or you're bending it the other way. And worst case scenario, if you notice the student says, I can't play low, hold it down. And then if they can play low, you can say, oh, it's an issue with your octave key. Go get it repaired. If you don't want to try to do that, then go send it out and get repaired, all right? But it's just an easy fix. I remember when I was in middle school, this wasn't touching this enough, and instead of bending the metal, I didn't know much about it, I just put some rubber bands around this piece so it connected better, and that fixed it. That just made it a little bit thicker. I've put tape around it before, but I feel like the easiest thing is just move that metal, get that adjusted, okay? And if that doesn't make sense, you can just enjoy the next repair tip. All right, so I have some clarinets where there's air coming out of these keys. And you'll notice these four keys should not be touching one another, okay? They should all be separated from each other. Mine's making a little clicking noise because this is probably one of the worst clarinets in the school. But a lot of times this key, if it falls on it, will bend up and bend into the other key. So when you're hitting the one, it will hit the other. And the quickest way to bend that key out is you're just going to get a trumpet mouthpiece, okay? And you're just going to put it on the end here, right inside here, and you could just bend the key. Just use some force, bend the key, and you just want to get it away from the other keys, and that will be an easy fix. Because you can't really do it with your hand, there's not a lot of purchase on here. So by putting the mouthpiece on here, then you can use the full weight of that mouthpiece, and you just bend the arm out a little bit. It's not really doing anything to the clarinet. It's not gonna adjust the spring. On these keys, they have different springs on the back. You're not adjusting any of that. You're just bending the metal of the long key. Most students won't even notice what you did. If their clarinet plays better, they'll thank you, okay? But it could be another thing where you're like, oh, these keys are all jammed up together, they're bent. All right, call the repair shop, send it in. If you don't want to do it, but at least now you can diagnose it. So now we're going to go on to a trombone repair. Most trombones just complain that their slide is not moving fast enough. Okay, I'm not really going to go over that today. Quick, easy repair is a slide lock stuck. The slide lock is a mechanism that turns one way to prevent the slide from moving. And then when you unlock it, the slide will move. A lot of times if a trombone's been sitting in storage, or sometimes people turn it all the way, it turns it off, you need to know where, how the slide mechanism functions. So I'm gonna actually take this slide off just so you can see what's inside here. This whole piece comes off. And not all of them look the same, but you can see inside here, there's a little tiny ridge, and that's connecting to that slide, okay? So, and there will be threads on one end, so that's the way you know it goes on. So you just slide it back in. Now, if it's stuck, I'll go over that in a second, because that's really the repair I'm talking about. And when you put the slide back on, remember, one side has the locking piece on it and the other slide does not. So make sure the locking goes with the locking piece over here. There you go. You bring it in and now it's locked. Okay. See, now it's not locking because I did it wrong. Okay. So you want to see where that piece is. There it is. Okay. Good. But if it's stuck, now this is really only if it's a school-owned trombone. I wouldn't do this to a student trombone, but if you have a set of wide pliers, something like this, okay, and you typically don't want to hurt the metal, you just put it around it, and you need to know righty-tighty, lefty-loosey, okay, so you want to make sure you're going the correct way. Once again, if you don't know which way it is, get another trombone, feel which way it goes. Just put the wrench attached. And once you feel like you kind of have a grip on it, you just turn it. Okay, now this can be very dangerous. All right, a lot of times you just need a tiny, tiny amount of cloth. You don't want to use a lot of cloth. Right now I'm adjusting the amount of cloth on there. And then I'm adjusting the pliers. And once you have this, it literally takes 3 seconds to unfreeze. Okay, and then once you have it, you just move it. So I'm doing this down here. Okay, as you can see, I'm putting this, and I'm just moving it this way. Okay. This could be a quick fix just to be able to use that trombone slide lock. If you have a student playing a school-owned trombone that doesn't lock, that could be very dangerous because then the slide could fall off, all right? And you don't want that to happen. Okay, so that's a quick fix, or send it out through the repair shop. Here, this next tip, this is not a long-term fix, but it is a fix, okay? This next fix requires a piece of paper. So many of you have probably had it, a student, saxophone, flute. I have a couple instruments I'm going to show you today. Here we go. Oh, my saxophone. The neck isn't staying on. It's too loose. And look, there's no screw here. Yikes. Usually the screw will tighten that up. Sometimes the screw's all the way in and it still doesn't work. So what do you do? Well, this is what I always suggest. And obviously, going to the repair shop, they'll put a screw in it, that will fix it. But if it's a student-owned instrument, they're not going to the repair shop anytime soon. Just take a little piece of paper, start with a piece of paper like this, and when you just push it halfway in here, and all right, and you'll notice, oh, it's still moving, so definitely not enough paper. All right, so let's try a little bit more. Okay, so let's try a bigger piece. I haven't worked with this saxophone, so now I'm taking this piece and I'm just folding it, okay? Now, this is definitely not a long-term solution, but if you want a student to actually play in your class and stop obsessing over this, this would be an easy fix. All right, so now it's a little bit tighter. So we've doubled the paper. Now let's triple the paper. Okay, so we're gonna fold it again. I'm folding it 3.5 times. There we go. All right, so now I'm finally getting a spot where it's kind of stiff. All right, now this saxophone has seen better days. The octave key does work. Once they have that there, they can always rip the paper off, especially if it's like a performance or a marching band competition. But the paper will hold it into place. It will only work pretty much for that performance until the saxophone gets put away. Now I'm going to show you the student flute. I have a student using a flute. This is the flute the school owns. It's not a very expensive flute, so I'm done paying money for getting it repaired. All right, this is the brand Medini. Okay, Mendini, okay? And this foot joint won't stay on it, always falls off. Now, I told this student to do this. She's tired of putting paper in there, but the paper will work. And unfortunately, the foot just keeps falling off. If you don't know anything about a flute, there's the head joint, the body, and the foot. So now I put a little piece of paper here, and now it should be a little bit better stuck together. I have this paper hanging out. Once again, if you want more paper, just take the same piece of paper, fold it in half, it makes it a little bit thicker. Find the edge that it goes into, fold that in. We tried taping it in here, that did not work. And this is even more of a snug fit, okay? So essentially the reason this is happening is this part is bent and it's not fully rounded out, so that's why it's falling out. But by putting this paper in there, it's filling in that gap, so it's a little bit tighter. Now you could put as much paper as you wanted in there, but that's kind of the fix there. So that's loose joints pretty much on saxophone necks and flute joints, usually the foot joint. Okay, with clarinet, there's usually corks. If you take apart a clarinet, there's usually these corks. Once the corks wear down, usually if you send your instrument out over the summer to get repaired, they'll replace all these corks. I have a repair kit that has replacement corks, and I've done natural cork replacements, but that definitely doesn't fall into the easy category. Today we're going with easy repairs. When you're telling students how to put things together though, always tell them to twist on and off for all of the parts. Twisting on and off, especially with a flute head joint. Okay, if they get in the habit of just slamming it on there straight in, then there's an easier chance it's gonna slip out. So by you're getting grooves in the metal by going back and forth, and this way the flute's used to twisting on and off. All right, the easier way is just to shove it right on, but that's not the correct way, and that's what causes the clarinet bell to fall off during performances. You always wanna twist on and off, okay? All right. Brass valve cap stuck. All right, so let's say the trumpet player brings you their trumpet. It's a school-owned trumpet, and they can't get the valve cap off, okay? This, and you may not like me in the comments, but this is where I use pliers sometimes too. You have to be very careful, and I'll tell you a story in a bit on how I broke something. But like I said before, I suggest taking a little rag, putting it around before you start so you're not putting any damage to the teeth there, and then just closing the pliers until you feel the teeth engage with the teeth on the valve, and then twist. All right, if you feel any like ripping, like you can feel the metal ripping against the metal, stop, because that means you're just stripping the teeth on the outside. If you look on the most of these valves, there's the valve cap part, there's little ridges, okay? And the same thing on these pliers, okay? So, but the same thing can be said for the bottom. The bottoms are gonna be stuck more because most students never take the bottoms off, but if you're gonna try the valve fix from repair tip number one, you're gonna wanna get that bottom off. Now, before I show you a couple other instruments where I'm going to take the valve caps off, there was an instance years ago where there was a marching baritone and I was trying to get the second valve cap off. So I had the first valve out and I was using the pliers in here and I ended up bending the valve casing of number one. So needless to say, that instrument was out of commission for the next month because I had to go to the repair store and they had to repair the valve casing. So that was a time where I was a little, I thought I was better than I was and I didn't really take those steps. So please be careful and use your judgment. All right, let me get a baritone, a couple baritones. All right, here's an old school baritone. Believe it or not, all of these valve caps work, but the bottom ones were stuck. So, oh, I got that one off. So we're gonna try this one right here. All right, and once again, you wanna know which direction they're going. So I'm twisting it this way. So I'm gonna put this around here. And I am left-handed. I've been doing a lot of this stuff right-handed for the video. So, and we wanna get good purchase around here. And you just want to, you want to go enough till you can feel it grip. And I have a little twist. And here it comes off. All right. So now I have this first one off. This is the first valve. And if you know anything about these brass instruments on these old baritones, I think most baritones, spring is separate. I'm a tuba player, so the spring pops out. And I can't get the second one out. This is where I went wrong before with that baritone. So I'm going to be very, very careful. And I'm going to put the rag around here again. And I'm going to open up these pliers. There we go. And I want to feel those teeth. Feel them grip. Okay. I don't feel it yet. And I got it loose. And you just need to turn it just so it's loose, so it breaks up the dirt. What happens is the dirt sits here, and then it just gets hard, and it just locks in place, kind of like a little bit of a glue. So here's the valve cap and the spring down there, and I was just showing you, you know, how that works. All right. Just going to put this back in. We're not cleaning any valves. I was just showing you what I do with the pliers. Now we're going to repair tip number 10. Repair tip number 10 involves black tape. Okay, this is what we call electrical tape. This is the tape I use on instruments, not duct tape, not scotch tape, not masking tape. This seems to leave the least amount of residue and it comes on and off easily. I don't suggest leaving this on your instrument for months at a time, but for a quick fix for a week or two or a month, especially if you're like concert night and you have some tape with you, this will definitely do the trick. Okay, so in one instance, you probably noticed my trumpet earlier, I have the pinky ring just fell off. It needs to be soldered back on. Usually I get the instrument serviced in the summer. So to get me by, I just put it back on and I ran the tape around a bunch of times. You use the same tape to tape drumsticks and whatnot if you do teach high school. So you may have some of this around. You could buy this in a 5-pack, you could buy this in a 10-pack. You could buy it in a 1-pack if you don't think you'll hardly ever use it. But for my woodwind instruments, my flutes, clarinets, and my saxophones, I have used this tape lots and lots of times. Especially, I had this old Barry sax in my old school. I must have taped up like 6 different keys, especially like the long rods near the end. I'll just show you here on the tenor sax. Some of these keys, if you're a saxophone player, you know, you typically don't use these 3 keys on the side. You don't really use them in middle school band. Elementary school band, I definitely don't think you use them. But on a Barry sax, they're even longer, and a lot of times they don't close all the way. So I just take a little piece of tape, and I just cover the hole. So I'll just show you, for example, let's just find the end of this tape. Okay, just gonna snip out a little square. So here we go, we have a little rectangle. And if this key was giving me an issue, I just open it up. Okay, open up that key, slide that tape underneath, oops, open up the key, slide the tape underneath, as you can see right there, and then close it. This way no one really sees, and it should be good. Now, if the key's a little bit too big, you could take another piece of tape and kind of crisscross it over the other way. And this way, if there's a leak coming out of there, you won't hear it, okay? That will just be covered. The only downside about taping a key, now you can't use that key. If you want to play the high F on a saxophone, you won't be able to play that high F because that key will not open anymore, okay? I had a student on saxophone the other day. He took a saxophone home, but on the back, we have a couple keys. We have, and they are controlled by these side keys. I teach B flat, two fingers, and the side key. Both of these keys were kind of stuck open. Not stuck open a lot, but they wouldn't close all the way. Something got dented along the way, and we haven't diagnosed the repair, but I just took tape, and I don't even think I covered the key. I covered the whole key, just held it down. He can't play that B flat. You can play B flat 1 and 1, which I do not recommend, but it's a temporary repair. Okay, I'm gonna show you on the clarinet, and I have a flute that already has some tape on it. We're gonna adjust that. But clarinet, once again, here's some keys that you don't typically use a lot. Over here, you have this key and you have this key. These are like alternate fingerings, trill fingerings. I hardly ever use these two. I use the bottom one a lot. But if these are giving you issues, okay, and I'm gonna tell you very soon about how to check if they're giving you issues, you can just put a little piece of tape underneath and that will kind of fix that, okay? I'm gonna tell you how to diagnose in a second, but let's look at that flute we looked at earlier, the flute that kept falling apart, okay? Not a very expensive flute. We still have a little paper in the back. You might have noticed I had some black tape on here earlier, okay? Now, remember before when I said the posts sometimes get bent? This post is a little, it's bent out. Because it's cheaper flute, I was able to bend the metal back, but for some reason this trill key didn't cover all the way, so I guess like a month ago, I taped it shut. We're actually gonna put that tape right on the key and see if that works any better. I'll be able to know tomorrow, okay? Now notice I didn't talk a lot about pads. I feel like changing pads and adjusting pads, that's the next level. Clarinet pads, saxophone pads, I'm all right with. Flute pads, that's a whole nother story. But all of that goes into the medium territory, okay? So it looks as though this flute pad is a little loose. So maybe that's why I closed it. But as you can see, I just cut out the piece of tape and I just put it underneath. This way the tape is less visible. Okay, and if you're going to a concert or you're going to marching band competition, you don't want to be running around with tape on all your instruments. But in a pinch, if you have a choice between this flute player playing all the songs or playing nothing, you can make that decision. I know the decision I would make. If you've watched this entire video, I think you've hopefully learned at least one or two repair tips. If not, you don't want to learn, or maybe you've picked up all 10 and you're like, oh, I'm going to use all of that. But I think it's good to have the repair company information in an email. I have an email set. I have a personal repair guy for like student-owned instruments. This guy, he just likes to do single instruments at a time. And then we have the local music store, and they have a huge repair shop, and they can fix it too. I have both of their information saved in a specific email. It's, you know, contact information. I can just search that up, copy that little block, and then I send that to the parent. Oh, I recommend, you know, your child's octave key on the saxophone is not working. I suggest going to this person. The saxophone works for now, but I suggest getting it looked at by a professional, especially when we get into the summer months when the student's going home. Maybe they're not doing a summer band program or a marching band program and they have a little bit of time off. That would be the time to get the instrument looked at, especially if you put some tape on it or you know they had issues with it, you know. There's been many times in my career where I've come against a screw that I can't get out, it's stripped, or it just doesn't seem to want to budge, even if I get a longer screwdriver. I stop then. I don't keep going. I'm not a repair technician. I'm just a band director who just wants to get my kids to play as much as possible. So I hope you learned a lot today about repairs. like I said, even if you took one repair tip, two repair tips, if you did like this video and you're not subscribed, please subscribe to the channel. Hit the like button. Comment below if you want to see some other repairs. I'm not going to do too many more very technical repairs, but I'll show some more repairs if you have some questions, or I'll give a little video on why I don't do that repair. So I wish you the best in your upcoming rehearsals with repairs, and have a great day.